Why an electronics in you know a telecom engineer becomes a monk? Why?
Yeah. Firstly, thank you for inviting me. I saw several of your podcasts, and it's a very important and invaluable initiative that you are doing to create increased awareness of the wisdom and culture of our tradition.
Yeah.
So my best wishes for you,
Thank
and
you,
as
sir.
well as appreciation.
Thank you, thank you.
So yes, so since my childhood, I had great faith in the power of education, in providing inner satisfaction, as well as in bringing about social transformation. And I was always among the top students in my school, but somehow I was never the topper. So I wanted to be the number one. I was second, third, joint first. So that was my dream. I should all come the first. And since my childhood, I was also fascinated by words. One of my childhood hobbies was just to pick up a dictionary and memorize words. So then when I was studying my engineering, I gave my GRE. And I was supposed to go to America. I have some relatives in America. They wanted me to come there and settle over there. So I gave GRE. And at that time, I came first in the whole state of Maharashtra, 2350 out of 2400. And it was all my dreams come true. And I felt elated, but only for a very short while. And then it struck me that, okay, there's no real satisfaction in just looking at the mark sheet. And people congratulate us, that gives some satisfaction. But how long does it last? So that was the time, that was one strand of thought which made me think, okay, I have some intelligence, I want to study, but where can I get enduring satisfaction through my studies? Also, I at that time was involved in a social welfare organization. And as a part of that organization, I would go to the nearby slums and try to offer free tuition classes to the slum children to teach English, math, history. And I became friends with them. And I realized that their lives were quite a mess. There was domestic violence, there was alcoholism, usually among the fathers. And I started thinking, how much is what I'm teaching really helping them? So I discussed with the leaders of that organization, and then we decided to go diversify into anti-alcoholism, helping people become free from it. And we did gain some success. We got some experts to come and give talks. One of my friends went to a nearby village, a very small village, and he managed to get the whole village to become free from alcohol. And we consider it to be a great achievement. But one day, so usually weekdays, twice or thrice a evening, we would go there for our tuition classes. And one evening he came back and he looked shattered. I asked, what happened? So he said that during the times when we had not gone, one of the days, a local political candidate who was competing for the municipality elections had come and offered truckloads of free liquor for everybody in the village. And not only the fathers, but even their kids had drunk. And we felt that, we were opening doors for people by providing them education. But I sense that there's something within us, within all of us as individuals, which sabotages us, which prevents us from choosing well. And this is not just obstructing people, say, in taking education. But I was in one of the top engineering colleges in India. I studied in the Government Engineering College, Pune. So there was one of my senior students had been a university topper for all his 4 years in the university. And he also happened to be a chain smoker. And he got one of the highest paying jobs in the history of our college. And yet, what happened was in 6 months of doing that job, he was diagnosed with advanced lung cancer. And he passed away within 1 year. So both of these events shook me. On one side, I didn't find intrinsic satisfaction through my own studies. Secondly, I saw that education is empowering in some ways, but education doesn't empower in terms of inner empowerment. So that was the time I started exploring something else. Now, I had memorized some verses of the Gita. I was brought up in a pious family, but I had never really studied it as a wisdom book. So a friend of mine at that time had become introduced to the Bhagavad Gita and he shared it with me. And I read it and two verses from the Gita struck me. In the third chapter, 36th verse, Arjuna asks the same question which was troubling me. Atha kena prayuktoyam papam charati purushah anichchanapi varshneya baladivaniyojitah. What makes us act self-destructively? Mm-hmm. So that I felt was a question which is so important for every one of us. And then as I started applying the principles of the Gita, now I was known to be quite short-tempered at that time. Mm-hmm. I found my anger issues going down substantially. One of my friends, my roommate itself in the hostel, was sliding toward alcoholism. And he started applying the principles of the Gita and he just was able to break free from it. So I started feeling that this is empowering me internally and helping me make a substantial contribution. So then I started studying the Gita and I started sharing it according to my capacity. And I started giving, I always was interested in public speaking. Mm-hmm. And now I had really something meaningful to speak based on the Gita. Mm-hmm. Not just share my ideas, but share the wisdom of the Gita. So I used to go to college hostels and small groups. I used to give talks. So then after I finished my graduation, I decided to work for some time in India because I was not sure if I go to America, then how my spiritual life will go on. I was at a crossroads. Mm-hmm. So I got into a multinational software company. I worked there for some time. And one evening, I was supposed to go for an evening talk for the on the Bhagavad Gita. Mm-hmm. And my boss told me that today we have got an urgent project deadline. So you'll have to stay on in the evening. Mm-hmm. So I tried to adjust and I tried to ask if some other speaker could go for that talk, but I couldn't arrange anyone. Mm-hmm. So I stayed on and then I did my project work. And then I came back that night, I was pondering, if I don't do this software work, there are hundreds of others who will do this work. Now, there's no minimizing the importance of software. That's also an important part of progressing of humanity. Mm-hmm. But there are many who will do it. But if I'm not sharing the wisdom of the Gita, how many other people are there to share it?
By that time, you have joined the ISKCON?
No, that time I was, my introduction to the Bhagavad Gita was, at that time itself, when I got the first Bhagavad Gita, that was the Bhagavad Gita by Srila Prabhupada. Mm-hmm. And then I started associating with the devotees who helped me understand the Bhagavad Gita better. So I attended classes, I studied. So that was the time. So it was about a journey of 2 years. In my third year of engineering, I was introduced to ISKCON. Mm-hmm. Through the Bhagavad Gita. So the introduction was primarily to Bhagavad Gita and through Bhagavad Gita to ISKCON. Mm-hmm. And then I started studying the Bhagavad Gita, understanding its message. And then after I finished my graduation, I worked for about a year. And then I felt that I would be able to contribute to society more by sharing the wisdom of the Bhagavad Gita. So the way I had scientific education and I mm-hmm. felt that if I could present the wisdom of the Gita in a rational and scientific way, I could contribute more to society. So the way I see it is, science and spirituality are like two giant mountains. They're both mountains of wisdom, mm-hmm. but we need a bridge between the two. So science can make things better and spirituality can make people better. And we bring both together, then we can make the world better.